prototype. Roger Patterson's ambitions went much further than writing a book. He borrowed money to direct a Bigfoot movie.
He was buying cameras and film footage and raw stock and horses.
It was while preparing to shoot his movie that Patterson claims to have caught a female Sasquatch on camera, totally by chance. It all sounds too good to be true. Since then, the film has been subjected to 40 years of scientific scrutiny. Biometric analysis of the creature's gait and stride length, to markers showing its height in the natural environment. No one has managed to prove it's a fake. Examining a digitally enhanced section of the film for themselves, the team can see why.
Interesting that they chose a female. I think that's a more difficult thing to fake, is that female anatomy, and it looks pretty natural. And so if it is a costume or if it is a suit, I think they've done it pretty well.
If Roger Patterson wanted to create a horse, why did he go to the trouble of creating an anatomically correct female? Ian Redmond agrees. The film seems too realistic to be a fake creature created by a rookie filmmaker.
The bits of the anatomy doesn't look very convincing. It appears to be shorter hair, slightly lighter hair around the waist. It just looks like the way it's silhouettes. But now it's in a little bit. And has a short hair there compared to the one behind the arms. It just looks like a silhouette. And in 1967, most people have not seen photographs of the roots. I think it's a very exciting film.
But the team disagreed on the head tone.
The part that really bothers me the most is the turn to look towards the camera. It looks so good to me.
But after hundreds of hours tracking gorillas in the wild, Ian Redmond is intimately familiar with how they move.
If you work with primates, you see that many of those mannerisms that make stop, listen, look are shared by all the primates, human and non-human.
This remarkable footage of a gorilla shot in a wildlife park shows how closely they can resemble humans when walking on 2 legs. The journalist Mike McLeod thinks he has the story that shatters.
Roger Patterson was broke and he had to provide for his family. And if you're making a film, you can spend a lot of money real quick. And you went through that money simply. I think that you went down and shot that film in California because you just needed to get that was the money shot. You needed the money shot. Because any film about Bigfoot, it ain't going to sell unless you got the money shot. And the money shot is the creature. Nobody's ever found the suit. It was either made a cowhide or it may have been rented from the costume. But in any case, we really like this artistic sensibilities to the film we shot in 1967, which has become an icon.
Jeff Malcolm disagrees.
This is anything but just a man in a pursuit. There wasn't experiments. There wasn't that. There wasn't anything but relatively cheap costume fur available, especially to an amateur, the one who tried to pull off the hose. If it's a hose, it really stands as one of the most sophisticated accomplishments of its time.
I have to say, actually, it's not. I mean, to me, I look at it, and given its history and so forth, you know, it fits me, and it's safe. It really does.
Roger Patterson went to his grave, taking the truth with him, swearing both his film and Sasquatch were real.
I don't think it's a Congress that Roger Patterson can believe the creature like that existed and then go out and shoot a fake film. It's actually quite interesting. That's his vision of what he wanted.
The team remained divided. Two believe that he believed in the Sasquatch. Two are unconvinced. One is undecided. But as our global map reveals, real or fake, one incredible fact is certain. In the years after Roger Patterson's film, places like Ohio, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Texas, and Montana, who have almost no previous history of Bigfoot sightings, have become sightings hotspots. In just 10 years, there are more sightings than in the previous 150, and they just keep coming. In all these eyewitnesses, we really see the
future. My experience helps us in the answer very few of the things that the challenge that we face is sifting the misidentifications, the over imagination of enthusiastic investigators, walking every bump in the night, every call.
The team decides to investigate this massive search. One of the places with the greatest rise in sightings of Bigfoot-like creatures is Florida. Here, locals claim to encounter a type of Bigfoot they call the skunk because of its terrible smell. In December 2000, these two photographs were sent to the Sarasota Sheriff's ideal habitat for me, but the scientists are highly skeptical of speaking.
There's a whole huge menagerie of habitats
for
communities, particularly in South Florida.
We know that primates and gardening habitats and chickens are so adaptable, and there's a lot of things that can do in Florida.
Keeping chimps and orangutans as pets became fashionable in the 1970s. Just no sightings of the skunk.
But the common issue is for people to buy a baby or infant primate, keep it until it's a bit older and stronger, and often they're purchased illegally when they're held without a license. And all it takes is 2 or 3 to start a population.
They live a long time. I mean, a chimpanzee can easily live to be 60 years old, so they only have a few years.
The team believes the huge surge of skunk ape sightings in Florida, more than 200, are a case of mistaken identity triggered by Roger Patterson's film. Sightings of skunk ape are probably nothing more than an escaped chimp. But not all clusters are easily explained. The biggest hotspot the team cannot dismiss is the Pacific Northwest. A region that stretches from Northern California up through Oregon, Washington State, and well into Canada. This area has an unbroken history of sightings. It is from this region that the word Sasquatch originates, and local Native Americans describe sightings of a tribe of hairy giants that date back centuries. This ancient wisdom may be the key to solving the mystery of Bigfoot. A team of scientists is searching for definitive evidence of Bigfoot. Having examined the famous 1967 film by Robert Patterson, they found it caused a massive surge in sightings. But some areas were more affected than others. The team's global map shows them that hundreds of sightings in the Pacific Northwest took place long before Patterson's film, This is Jimmy Chapman and the young children. They are a respectable folk, newly trusted in the local community. It's a typical afternoon. The kids are playing, and Jimmy's hanging her laundry. Her husband Jeff is at work in the building.
They're alone.
Their home is miles.